Okay, I'm gonna go ahead and dive in. My name is Dr. Wes Fondren. I'm the Associate Dean of the Graduate School at Coastal, the College of Graduate and Continuing Studies. I teach in the Communication Department. My PhD is actually in Communication Science. I used to be part of the marketplace for about 15 years. I owned an IT business and spent the last 5 as the Chief Technology Officer for a large company back in Alabama. And so I can appreciate a lot of the marketplace pressures, and I ran my own IT business for a few years, and so I can sure appreciate people that are running their own businesses as well. I'm confident some of the stuff that we're going to talk about today will be helpful. I had a student, actually he's part of the real estate group, his name's Travis Worthy, that stopped me. I had Travis probably 10 years ago, and I saw him at a coffee shop recently, and he mentioned this theory. And he said, I still use that every day at work, and so I'm hopeful that some of this will be helpful for you. And even apart from work, I hope it'll be helpful in just personal life sort of stuff. I use it all the time. My kids use it all the time to help with stress and to help make sense of some things. Because part of what we're going to be talking about is how other people behave when they are stressed and how to reduce other people's stress through language. And so I'm gonna go ahead and dive in. It's good to see some of you that I saw before. Who wasn't here the first time? Oh, okay, good. A few people. So I'm gonna the slide at the very beginning. I'm gonna use to kind of review to kind of get us to the same spot. But before I do that, I need to talk about the subtitle of the class or the title at the very top about superpowers. I won't go through the same spiel I did last time. But we as a culture are obsessed with superpowers. Marvel movies, Spider-Man, Batman, Superman, Ant-Man, you name it, man. We've got tons of those. We've got 7 Harry Potter movies on top of, stacked on, $1 billion in sales and books. When I was a kid, it was Star Wars, where the superpower was the Force. And now we've got, feels like 100 of those movies. And it's not just entertainment. When I was a child, we used to play like we had superpowers. When I was a little kid, it was the $6 million man. That was his, special powers. He was bionic. Since I was a little kid, I remember playing games, or I would have dreams that I could breathe underwater, or I could walk through a wall, or whatever. And this idea of having a power that other people don't have is a deep part of us, maybe at a psyche level. And that's actually what we do in education, right? You go to school to get knowledge or a power that other people don't have, so you can say, I can balance your books. You can't balance your books. I can do that for you. Or I can make you well, or I can whatever. We go to school to develop these powers, not just information. I have a whole lecture series that I'm doing right now that is on fire because it's about ChatGPT. And everybody wants a piece of ChatGPT, artificial intelligence. And it is not coming. It's been here for about 6 months. And it is the thing that is going to shape education dramatically. It's going to shape the marketplace. And people are looking for a superpower. Teach me how to use this incredibly powerful tool so I can use it and I'm not the one who's not using it. But anyway, my point in all this is that superpowers. And one of the most amazing superpowers, and it's really hard for me to get my students to embrace this or realize it, is communication. But if you think about your job, think about your personal life, you think about how many conflicts you've had that were miscommunication. Like last time we talked about the role of expectations, pre-communication before communication actually happens. I mean, you think about how many conflicts you've had because someone had an expectation they did not communicate to you. And you found out afterwards that, why are you so upset? I just can't believe you didn't. Like, what made you think I was going to? Well, and you realize they thought something was going to happen that you didn't line up with. Or customers. That you never hear that their expectations weren't met. That's what we talked about last time. That's a superpower. Being able to assess someone's expectations before communication happens, that is powerful. Conflict resolution, that's another one that's part of this series. Being able to resolve conflict or avoid it. And I don't mean like avoid, like not deal with it. I mean like deal with it before it becomes conflict. That's powerful, where it's not resolving a conflict as much as it is, like I said, dealing with it before it actually blossoms into full-blown conflict. That's powerful. And today's dealing with stress is a superpower. And I mentioned this last time, and this is not targeted anyone here. I really don't know hardly anyone in here, just from, you know, acquaintance sort of thing. Most people think they're good at communication, and they're not. Or they're not as good as they think they are. And part of the problem is that because they don't know communication at a deep level, it's kind of like the person who thinks they're funny because they don't understand humor. Do you know that? You've met someone like that? They think they're hilarious, and everyone else knows they're not as funny as they think they are. Well, as I said last time, most people think they're good at communication because they've seen it done poorly. They think, the same thing happens with my job. Like, I could probably be a good teacher because I've seen bad teaching and I know how to recognize it. Or they think they're going to be a good parent because they've seen bad parenting. Or they think they know how to be a good friend because they've had a bad friend. They're like, well, I'm not doing that. And they think recognizing bad makes them good. That's like recognizing bad food and thinking that makes you a chef. That's not the case. And so I spend a good bit of time, we have a master's in communication leadership. I spend a good bit of time unlearning some stuff for some of our students because they've learned some bad public speaking habits or communication tools, like social media is a communication tool for us. And so today is going to be a little bit of that. And there may be a little bit of unlearning, but hopefully this is fresh, new stuff that you've never seen before. And even if you don't ever use it in a workplace, I hope it's helpful for you in your personal life. And so let me go ahead and dive in and talk about the main topic. And I apologize to those of you that were here last time. You saw this before, but I've got to just get us back to the same spot. And what I asked last time was, what is communication? And there are tons and tons of models of what communication is. This is just one of the early simple ones. There's a fascinating story about how we got it, but I don't have time to tell it right now. And there was a gentleman named Harold Laswell that said, really, communication breaks down into four parts. And that's what we do as scholars and stuff, is when we want to understand something, we break it down to its parts. When you go to the doctor and they want to figure out if your blood is healthy, they break it down into its parts. And the fancy word for that you know is analyze. It means to, you know, some of you are in real estate. If I wanted to know what the value of a house was, you'd break it down into its parts. What's the roof like? What's the structure like? What's the heating and cooling or whatever? And then you'd take all those pieces and you'd put them back together and say, yep, this is what this house is worth. Well, this is how we do message analysis or communication analysis, is we break down the parts. Like we look at the stuff the sender did. We look at the actual message itself. We look at how the audience received it and understood it, and then what the outcome was. And this is great in conflict resolution because it often helps us target where the breakdown was. It's also great in advertising analysis. Advertising is under our umbrella of like advertising PR sort of thing. If figuring out why the message, someone's spending a bunch of money on advertising, but they're not getting the outcome, and often they just think, I got to change the message. I need to change the message. The message wasn't good enough. But often it has to do with other parts of this. And so anyway, I just wanted to reintroduce this idea because we're going to work off of it today. So one thing that I didn't mention last time, I don't think, was that when communication was first becoming a field, now obviously communication has been around for thousands of years, but studying it at the level we study biology and other things actually happened right after World War II. When World War I happened and we had our first draft, the government ended up drafting people and putting them in places they didn't belong. We learned a lot in the First World War. We didn't think we were going to have another one. We didn't call it World War I. Someone says, I'd like to introduce you to my first wife, because you don't know there's a second one coming. And so we called it the Great War. We didn't call it World War I. And so when it happened again, the second time, we drafted people differently. And one of the things that they did was they took scholars and they put them in their field and said, you know about electronics, you go do radio, and that'll help us with the radio effort. And you understand political science, you stay home and help us with figuring out public support. And they started doing this, and during the war, there was a moment, and this is so crazy, where there was a gas shortage, and there were four scholars that had to carpool. And I don't know if you've ever carpooled or you did it in high school or whenever, but most of the time when people carpool, they do the same thing while they're in the car together. You know what they do? They talk about where they're headed. So high school kids are like, what are you doing today? It's like, oh, I got a test in Miss Jones' biology class. What are you doing? Oh, coach is making this. And or if you're driving to work, you know, hey, Carl, how's work? That sort of thing. And that's what they did. And you had, there was a mathematician, there was a speech writer, there was a electrical engineer, and I forgot what the other guy was, and they would carpool every day. Well, that's where this came from. One day, one of the guys realizes, holy smoke, we're all doing the same thing. Like the math guy is doing codes. He's making these codes so that the enemy doesn't hear, understand our messages if they intercept them. Well, that's this. That's a coder encoding a message that has to be decoded so someone knows what their orders are. And the radio guy realized, holy smoke, that's what I'm doing. I've got a transmitter that sends a signal to a receiver so someone can hear, you know, whatever's going on. And the speechwriter guy, he said, holy smoke, that's what I do. I'm writing for the president to say something to the American people to get them to support the effort. And they all realized we're doing the same thing from different directions, and the field of communication was born. And the radio guy, his name was Claude Shannon, he took this and he changed it to this. And it was the exact same idea, but he was at MIT, and after the war was over, he went back to MIT, and he said, this is it. This is what we're doing. He called it information theory, but it's communication. And you can see the exact same thing. He doesn't have outcome on here, but he has, you know, the person speaking into the transmitter, it goes to the receiver, and then it goes to your ear. And this same thing happens to your cell phone and that sort of thing. Well, he wanted to understand, let's see, okay, great. He wanted to understand when communication broke down, what was the problem. And for him, in radio, this was often the problem. Like this, does anybody remember when our cell phones were analog and you had static? Anybody remember static on cell phones? I'm going through a tunnel, I can't, that sort of thing. Well, that is this idea. It's that you start losing your signal, you get down to one bar or whatever, and or there's some kind of noise or something that that causes a problem. And one of the industries that embraced this was advertising. Has anyone ever been to Times Square? Can you what's your name?
Andrea.
Andrea, can you describe to the people that haven't been what Times Square looks like?
It's just like lots of light, lots of activity.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Can anybody think how Times Square relates to what I just showed you? Visual noise. And what happens is the advertising doesn't work in a lot of the places because it's surrounded by so much visual noise. You have this, and trying to get your message out to your customers, or trying to talk to your employees, or trying to have a conversation with your teenager. Like, I try to have a conversation with my kids, and they've got so much noise going on from text messaging and from things on their phone or whatever is happening on the computer. I have to reduce the noise to be able to have a conversation with them. And you have this, I'm sure, with people in your life. And we use this model for lots and lots of things to figure out how to get our message through noise. And I'm not trying to be crude here. There are a handful of things that advertising figured out a long time ago would cut through the noise. Anybody think of any of those? What sells?
Visuals.
Yeah, somebody's about to say it.
Yeah. Yeah.
Sex sells. And as crude as it may sound, no matter what your product is, if you put a billboard on 501 and you put a lady in a bikini on it, it's going to get more attention than if you actually put your product up there. It's evolutionary. It's part of, you know, humor is something else that sells, because humor dumps a bunch of dopamine in our brain that says, ooh, this feels good. And so when you watch all of those commercials during the Super Bowl, people end up remembering the ones liking the ones that are funny, because it gives us some joy in our brain. Novelty, something that's brand new. If Apple comes out with a brand new product, it doesn't matter how good or bad it is, just the fact that it's new and it's novel will cut through some of the noise. And there are a handful of techniques for cutting through noise. Part of what we're going to talk about today is this. But before I do that, I need to talk about Taylor Swift. And so my students call her Tay-Tay. I'm sure it's not just my students, but my students call her that. And when she first got started, when she first got started, she was about 17 years old, and she won a MTV Video Music Award. And I want to show you her getting that award.
Taylor Swift.
That's Kanye West.
I'm really happy for you. I'm gonna let you finish. But Beyonce had one of the best videos of all time. One of the best videos of all time.
Okay. So, before we talk about it at all, somebody tell me what was the first thing that came in your mind when you saw that happen? Disrespect. Okay. You can be crude. The words I usually get are fairly crude when I do this at Coastal. Okay, what's the first thought that you think? Okay, not you. The viewers at home. When the viewers at home saw this, what do you think the first thought was that went through their mind when they saw this?
Oh, shit.
No, he didn't.
No, he didn't. What a jerk. I'd be willing to bet that's what most people thought when they saw that was, at the very least, wow, that was a jerk. What a jerk thing to do. Or he was being super disrespectful. And if you don't know what just happened, she was in the middle of accepting her award at 17. And I don't know if you can imagine how much time she probably put into her wardrobe, her acceptance speech, her first moment. Now we know her as a superstar. This was her first big moment. And he got out of the audience, came up on stage, took the microphone out of her hand, and said, hers was better.
Even Beyonce looked embarrassed.
Right. He drew attention to her. Interesting thing happened later in the night. So the award ceremony goes on, and it kind of builds to the final award that's like the big artist of the year whole thing. And so I'd like to show you the artist of the year winning their award.
Beyonce!
The person he had pointed out, Beyonce's was better. Okay. Oops. So, what do you think the first thing people thought when they saw that?
She has always been a class act.
Classy. Somebody else give me a couple of thoughts, or reworded or whatever.
Redemption.
What'd you say?
Redemption.
She's larger than life. I mean, she made it.
Okay. Empathetic?
Yeah.
Now, what's really interesting about both of these things that I just showed you was I never asked you to say anything about their character. I just asked you what you thought about the videos. You could have said, oh, they were both wearing it. First thought was they both wore a red dress. Or my first thought was, that was a good song. I'm glad she won for it. Our first thought was, Lady Gaga is weird. It was like you could have had 1,000 thoughts, 1,000,000 thoughts maybe, about visuals, about color, about all sorts of things. But the first thing you thought about was a character judgment. What's wrong with you? I'm kidding. You made a character judgment about these people, for good and bad. Like, Kanye's a jerk. Or that was, he is so disrespectful. The president, he's a jackass. Those are character statements. Beyonce, that's classy. That was very large of her. That was really, she did a very redeeming thing, that sort of thing. Those are all character judgments. Now, why would strangers make character judgments about other strangers? That's not like one of your kids that you're trying to figure out if they have good character or not. These are total strangers. Why would that be the first thing that comes to your mind? judgmental. That's we need other shirts made. I'm judgmental. That's my superpower. That's right. I can do it faster than a speeding bullet.
Kindness.
Doesn't that seem a little weird to you? When you take a step back and think about how quickly your brain moves to character judgments about other people that you don't know, that you'll probably never meet. I mean, there's probably not many of us or any of us in Myrtle Beach that's going to be running into Beyonce anytime soon. But we still make character judgments about them. And we hold opinions about them. Hey, did you see the MTV Awards last night? Yeah, that Kanye, he's a jerk. What a jerk. Well, this plays into what we're talking about. If you go back to the theory that we were looking at, or actually, let me pause to the theory we were looking at for a second and talk about another one for a moment. There's a psychological theory, half of my PhD is in cognitive psych, and there's a psychological theory called attribution theory. Attribute means to give credit to, what's your name?
Kyle,
that's right. Sorry, you told me that last time, I forgot. Like, if Kyle had helped me build this presentation, I'd say, hey, before I get started, I need to give attribution to Kyle. He helped build this. And so it's giving credit to or recognizing something in someone else. And the underlying ideas behind this theory are people watch people. That's what we do. We don't look away. We don't, you know, disinterest. We watch people. We at the mall, walking down the street, sitting in this room, we're observers of people. Even when we're minding our own business, we still watch people. We watch people, and we watch them because our superpower is making judgments about their character. And it starts in the womb. We see infants coming out, making judgments about watching people and making judgments about people. You remember probably when you were a little kid. You know, first grade, you saw some kid drop their bag and another kid picked them up and you probably thought, oh, Becky's nice, right? Or you thought, I'm not playing. Or maybe you had a sibling and you're like, Steve's not nice. Big brother Steve's not nice. I don't like Steve. Or maybe you had a little sibling that came along and you're like, this one stinks. I don't like this new one. Or there were adults that even as a little kid, you made character judgments about. Mom, I don't like him. I don't want to go to their house, whatever. We've been doing this as far back as our brain started developing, as far as we know. And we do see infants in utero adjust to different voices and make changes and move towards some and away from others, which we know is a judgment call. That attraction and aversion happens even in utero. And so we've been doing this. This is our superpower. It's in our DNA in some ways. We've been doing this for a long time. The question is, why? So what I just told you was, nobody had to teach you how to do that. When you feel guilty about judging someone else's character, just know that that's written into the very fabric of who you are. It's been happening since before you were born. Why is that?
I think it's a survival
mechanism. Yes, it is. It is because, oops, wrong way, because we hate something. There's something as human beings that we despise, and that is uncertainty. We hate uncertainty. When you were a little kid and you were afraid of the dark, Like, you knew there wasn't a monster. Or you thought the chances were pretty good there was not a monster under your bed. But my kids, the moment I turned that light out, they said, "Dad, don't forget the nightlight." I was like, "Son, I just turn your light off. I got to take 2 steps to the hall to turn the nightlight on. Just don't forget." Like, I never forgot in either life, but they always, "Don't forget the nightlight." They hated being in the dark. And I mean, even as adults, we kind of hate that too. I mean, if for some reason right now all the power went out and all the light, and all of a sudden you were sitting in pitch black darkness, and I mean pitch black, your anxiety level would go up. I don't know what's going on around me. I have a high degree of uncertainty about what's happening because I can't see anymore. We hate uncertainty. We've hated it since we were babies. Stephanie said, survival. We try to reduce our uncertainty to predict the future. And I don't mean like the stock market, although that'd be kind of cool. I mean trying to figure out, when you were a baby, is this a good person for me to be around or a bad person? This lady, she comes and she feeds me, she's good. Like, and when she shows up, there's milk. I like her. Character judgment, she's good. This other one, every time I go, you know, every time we leave the house and go to this place, this guy sticks me with something that hurts my feet. I don't like going here. And we get upset by going to the doctor's office. We even as babies, right? I had a friend of mine, his son, I was taking his son to do, we're going to go do something fun. And his son was about 2 years old, and he started just bawling when I got ready to park the car. And he's like, "I don't want to go, I don't want to go, I don't want to go." And I was like, "What's the matter, Ben?" He said, "I don't want to go, I don't go." And I realized the only time he ever parked in a parking deck was when he went to the doctor's office. And I had just parked in a parking deck. And he was trying to figure out, he was trying to predict the future. He's like, "Bad things happen when you park in a parking deck." Like, he was trying to reduce his uncertainty. We all do that. When you meet someone for the first time, you begin trying to reduce your uncertainty. You may never meet Kanye, but you've already started building a profile in your mind of what he's like. Just in case you meet him or someone asks about him or whatever. Someone cuts you off in traffic, you're like, jerk. Most people don't think, "Oh, I hope they get where they're going. They must be in a hurry. I'm glad they got in front of me because they must be in a bigger hurry than I am." No, we think something about their character. And uncertainty reduction is one of the main goals of our life. I did a version of this talk back in February for hospice. You talk about people that are looking for some uncertainty to be reduced. Those people are on the front lines of that. Where they're with a dad that's passing away, or the kids their work, the adult children that are asking them questions over and over again. Is this normal? Should this be happening? And that's all they're doing. Medical is a small piece of it. Uncertainty reduction is a big chunk of it. How much do you think that's worth in the marketplace? Exactly. That's worth a lot, being able to reduce people's uncertainty. That's the ChatGPT thing, by the way. If you don't know what that is, it's a new artificial intelligence tool that people are using to get information and make connections that other people don't have, so they can they feel like they have a better handle of what's going on. Okay, let's talk about this for a second. This is a merging of the two theories that I showed you. I showed you the one about information. Remember the radio guy, transmitter, sender, transmitter, or source, transmitter, receiver. And we're always judging people because we're trying to figure out what they're like. We're trying to make judgments. And that judgment, that uncertainty, is the noise that gets in the way of the message. Like, if you can imagine when you were in school, like the very first day of class, the very first thing I do is I give out a syllabus. And I pass it around and I say, "Here's what we're going to do this semester." That whole process is trying to reduce the uncertainty of the students. Because they walk in the door thinking, "What's going on? What's about to happen? What will be expected of me? What's this class going to be like? Should I stay in this class? What am I going to have to do? Is this going to be a lot of work?" And all those questions, I hand them a syllabus to start trying to answer it. And they're also trying to figure out what I'm like. And they've already begun that process when they talk to their classmates or hit rate my professor or whatever, which I'm going to talk about here in a second. But that first day of class, that's what I'm doing. When you meet your customers for the first time, they're trying to reduce their uncertainty. That real estate agent I was talking about, one of the things that I taught in the class was, if you can reduce people's uncertainty, all of a sudden your message starts getting through better. Because uncertainty gets in the way of because their mind is so busy trying to figure other things out, it gets in the way of communicating. It creates noise, creates cognitive noise. And so the more you can reduce that, it increases the likelihood of being heard. I have another talk called Being Heard that's got some of this in it. And it also increases your ability to persuade people, which I'm going to show you here in a second. Now, yes, ma'am, Layla.
Was that Being Heard class filled with females?
It was filled with old people.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah, and but I will say this, and to talk about gender stuff, and I don't mean to overgeneralize because I know that some guys are an exception to this. The understanding of what being heard means is different from males and females. We call it report versus rapport. Report says, give me the information, I'll give it back to you, I'll show you I heard you. Rapport says, I'm here with you in this. I empathize. I am in this with you. I'm trying to understand. I get it. I'm there. We have this relationship side of it. And the way you reflect that back is different. Reflecting back the report side is, so, and I used to be bad about this. I was married for a super long time, and my wife would say something to me, and I would repeat it back to her, and she's like, I feel like you're not listening to me. I'm like, I just told you what you just said. She's like, yeah, but I feel like you're not listening to me. And I didn't understand, you know, that she wasn't looking for a report. Here are the three things you just told me. She was looking for me to understand and get and show her that I understood. And so, it is a little, there's some gender, and some of that's culture, like our culture. But there's probably some, and there's a bunch of wonky statistics out there you've probably heard, like that women use 5,000 more words a day than men do, or that 80% of communication is body language. There's all sorts of, there is no scientific evidence for any of those things, but they're so believable because of our own experience, people believe them. And there's no way to measure what percentage of communication is body language. There's just not. I mean, yes, ma'am.
And you have to say, I'm here with you.
Yeah.
And it brings them comfort.
Yeah.
I'm with you. I'm on your level.
So the conflict resolution talk has a piece of that in it, because that is a huge part of it. You're right. Yeah,
being. It, you know, just yeah. Make them feel that I'm not against you. I'm with you.
Yeah. Yeah. So I've been showing you a bunch of theoretical stuff. And in research, what we do is we start with the theory and we move to the practical. Because if you can understand the big picture, you can figure out how to apply it. That we don't ever really start with this little tiny piece and say, this is how we're going to understand everything upward. We go the other direction down, like you've seen, like this. And so what I want to do is I want to move from the theory to the very, very practical application. Something you can leave with, but I need to finish up the uncertainty reduction first. The theory says that we are always trying to reduce our uncertainty, and we do that to predict the future, which I told you a minute ago. I'm watching people. You guys have been, and this doesn't hurt my feelings, you guys have been judging me since before you got here this morning. Maybe you heard something about it, or you saw my name, or you saw my title, or you saw something, and you started trying to figure out what this was going to be like, and what I was going to be like, and what my students, like I said, they do it constantly. They're constantly trying to figure out what a teacher's like. We all do this with doctors, with people in waiting rooms. You sit down beside someone in a waiting room, a total stranger, and you're looking at their clothes, and you're looking at how they behave, and trying to figure out what they're like. It's just a constant thing that we're doing, trying to make predictions about the future. Okay, so now I want to talk about the practical stuff, the really specific side. So, we are all trying to reduce our uncertainty. We have uncertainty that we don't even realize. We have constant uncertainty, actually. And so do your customers. So do your partner in life. It never stops, by the way. It's never that we get to the place where we feel like we've got our husband completely figured out. Or that we might think we know the other person completely. But there's always moments where, like, why would Steve do that? Or the opportunity for uncertainty is always there. And this happens a lot in conversation. We're trying to figure out, what we do is we go to character. Now, he may have said, hey, how are you doing? But your brain says, why would he ask me that? what were his motives for asking me how I'm doing? And we're always trying to figure out what's going on with the other person, because you can never know someone totally. And so one of the things that we do to reduce our uncertainty is we talk. Not a shocker. These will get progressively more interesting. This one's not that interesting. So I'll start out with it. Like, we talk. You go to a waiting room. You give them your name. They say, we'll be right with you. You sit there for 30 minutes. There's another person in the waiting room, and you're thinking, you got a high degree of uncertainty. Like, how long am I going to be here? Eventually, you're going to lean to that other person and say, have you been here for a long time? Did they say anything? This is what we do. When we meet someone for the first time, like, I walk into a room, and Kyle is there. I say, hi, Kyle. My name's Wes. And I start talking, giving your customers or your clients or whatever an opportunity to talk sometimes is important. We have a lot of information we want to give them. And we're maybe trying to reduce their uncertainty, but creating spaces for them to be able to talk is a way that they will reduce their uncertainty. First day of class, I always give students a chance to interact and ask some questions. And they think it's a little cheesy, you know, first day of class kind of stuff. That's fine that they think that. About 3 weeks in, they realize, oh, that was that uncertainty reduction thing you were doing the first day. And I was like, that's right. And sneaky. So talking. We'll skip this one because it's the easiest one. This one is interesting. Nonverbal warmth. I said a minute ago, we have no idea what percentage nonverbal communication is, but we do know that nonverbal communication is important. And we do know that people watch other people and make judgments of them based on nonverbal information. Can you think of a way that people communicate nonverbally? Yeah. Their facial expressions, that's right. Smiling. Eye contact. And there's great research on all of these. Like, they've done field research, like not in a lab, like at banks, where they told one teller to smile and one not, and people beat a path to the one that was smiling. Eye contact. People felt a sense of connection with other people.
The way they
dress. About clothing every day. Even my students, I have students that say they don't care about how they dress. So they'll come to class in like pajama pants and like a t-shirt with holes in or something, and flip-flops are like, I don't care how I look, this doesn't matter to me. But I can tell you, if I handed them a shirt that says, I have an STD, they would not wear that shirt, right? Or I've got a nasty rash, or, you know, or whatever, right? Or whatever, they do care. Or the other way around, if the only thing that was clean in their closet was their prom dress because they hadn't washed it in 6 weeks, they're not gonna wear that to class. They do care how they look. Acting like they don't care is what they're trying to communicate. It started a long time ago. Kurt Cobain, Holes in the Clothes, the show I Don't Care. That's grunge. That clothes matter. You know this. Tons of research on this. You probably know this. Navy blue, black, dark gray, those are colors of authority. If you have to speak to somebody and you have to be an authority in that moment, you're going to want to wear one of those colors if you want that extra reduction of uncertainty on their part. You'll never see a police officer in a pink uniform. You're never going to see a judge in a yellow robe. You'll never see a presidential candidate get up to give a speech in a lime green coat. They're going to wear a navy blue or black coat. They're going to wear a black robe. They're going to wear a dark, dark uniform. Because those are colors that we associate with authority. Now, the opposite's true of warmer colors, reds, especially softer reds, softer brown, softer, you know, orange, that kind of. Those warmer colors are the opposite. We associate those things with attraction. Maybe evolutionary. Some people believe it has to do with food, that we associate those colors with food because we eat things that are green and red and, you know, these sorts of things. But they're warmer colors. And there's literally a gigantic field called the psychology of color and that sort of thing. And so, but it's not just clothes and color and body language. I mean, you know this, the car you drive. Like when you pull up at a red light and you know someone's doing some uncertainty reduction about me because of this car. There are lots and lots of things that we can do. And they don't even have to do with you sometimes. In my office at work, I have, well, I'll come back to this. Coffee, cookies, breakfast, music, you name it. Think about the things that communicate warmth to another person. I mean, can you imagine if you went to a party and there was no music? Lame-o. Or no food, or no food, or no people. Think about when you go to the stores in the mall. You know, some of them are pumping out aromas. You can't go walk by Abercrombie without, you know, being accosted by, you know, cologne. They pay lots of. We have a fascinating theory about that one. They pay lots of money for that to happen, and they play music, and they have attractive images, and they have shirts on a table that they could easily hang up. They got a high school kid there folding shirts all day, paying them to fold those shirts. They could easily put on a rack. You know why they want them folding the shirts? Because you'll touch it. If it's hand level, you're going to pick it up and look at it, or touch it at least. They'd be more than happy to pay that kid to do the same thing all day as opposed to you walking by a rack and just looking at it. There are lots of things you can do to create warmth that people will use to reduce their uncertainty about you and the environment you're putting them in. Information seeking. This one is becoming, has become, very digital. Like when you want to know something about somebody now, it used to be that you'd call Aunt Martha. Hey, Aunt Martha, do you know anything about so-and-so? This is what happens with my students when they go to the club at night. They go out to a, you know, Senor Frog or some club or something, and they see a friend of theirs talking to someone they're interested in. And so they make their way over to their friend, and they're like, hey, I saw you talking to that gal. Do you? That's not how they talk. Do you know her? Do you know her? And they're like, yeah, we had a whatever class together. Like, oh, what do you know? And they'll do information seeking. Same thing we do. Hey, Steve, how's it going? We talk to him for 2 or 3 minutes. They're like, hey, I was thinking about doing whatever, and I know that you, and we information seek. Or someone sends you an Instagram follow request, or a Facebook follow, a friend, whatever, and you don't remember the name, first thing you do is information seeking. You go try to look at, and you hate it when their like profile picture is like a squirrel. You're like, come on. Yeah. I'm trying to get some information here. Yeah, I'm trying to get some information here. And it's frustrating for people when they can't get that information. That's what you do with your website, right? Most websites, this is both IT, communication, and psychology together. Lots of websites are terrible because they're trying to dazzle people with technology, and they really need to be reducing their uncertainty. If you can let me get to my information quickly, that will make me feel better about you. I talk about this I do a class on job interviews. Most of my students have the complete wrong idea about how to be interviewed. They think I've got to come in there and impress them that I'm the best person in the world. And so when they get asked a question like, tell us about one of your weaknesses, they think, I got to spin that. I just try too hard. I throw myself too hard in what I do. I take on too many tasks. I'm just a perfectionist. And they'll try to make a compliment sound like a weakness. But if they really said something that reduced the uncertainty, it's like, hey, I struggle with taking on too much work, and I've had to really work on it over the years. I have a hard time sometimes saying no, and so I've had to really use my Outlook calendar a lot. And so I have to really, I've developed some coping mechanisms, but that's something I struggle with. Well, that is an uncertainty reduction there. By the way, that's true. That's uncertainty reduction. Because you say, here's the actual weakness I have. Here are the things I've done to cope with it. It is still a struggle for me. It's something I still work on. And what will happen is the interviewer will say things like, they don't know this. They'll say, I don't know, I just felt better about that third candidate. I don't know, I felt like I had a better feel for what he was like. That's information seeking, whether it's a website, your name tag, or whatever. If you think about approaching your interaction with reducing someone's uncertainty, it'll often change the way you shape the message. This one's fun. I don't know if you noticed when I walked up, and I gave the example about Kyle being in the room. Did you notice the first thing that I did when I said, oh, Kyle, you know, I walk into a room and Kyle's here. Did you notice the first thing I did? I gave him my hand. Here, take my hand. And I gave him my name. I am disclosing stuff about myself to him. Hey, I'm Kyle. I mean, I'm Wes. I'm Wes. Yeah. What's wrong with the communication guy? Judgment. Judgment. You guys are terrible. Your superpowers are... And it goes beyond that. It goes beyond just giving our name and stuff. This is going to sound backwards, probably. The more I reveal about myself, the more comfortable I become with you. This sounds crazy. First day of class, I have the students do that whole, you know, tell me something about yourself, blah, blah, blah. And we go through and they tell me where they're from and all that stuff. And then I always leave a couple of open-end ones where I say, tell me something that's unique about you, or tell me something that's a favorite of yours. Or so. I give them like 4 or 5 options so they can pick from it. What they don't realize is that what I'm trying to get at is them becoming more comfortable with me. Because what they'll tell me is what they want me to know. I'm a big fan of the Dallas Cowboys. I grew up watching the Cowboys. I'm a big fan. And they'll tell me these things. And they become more comfortable with me as I know that. Your clients become more comfortable with you the more you know about them. They like you. At least he knows I'm a Cowboys fan. Or at least he knows X about me or whatever. That as they share information they want you to have, they will feel better about you. It reduces their uncertainty about how you feel about them. Because that's one of the things they're concerned about too. How do you feel about me? And when they share information, it makes them feel better. As they disclose information about themselves, it reduces their uncertainty. Think about the clothes people wear. Where's Amanda? Amanda, do you ever wear Gamecocks paraphernalia? Okay. How do you feel when someone says, hey, go, you have just disclosed something about yourself that you like other people knowing, right? I'm from Alabama. You probably tell from my accent. I lived in Tuscaloosa, which is the home of the University of Alabama. I went to school there. My PhD is from there. And I wear Alabama stuff. And when I walk through the mall and someone says, hey, Roll Tide. I'm like, yeah, Roll Tide. That's right.
War Eagle.
Oh, my goodness. That is the... That's the opposite of uncertainty reduction right there. You guys see who's doing the teaching, though, right? Self-disclosure. I feel better when people know things about me. Think about the things you tell people at a party. Think about the things you tell people when you meet them for the first time. Often you tell them your credentials, the things that you feel like make you believable or of value or important or whatever. And it's different for everybody. You know, it may be that your value comes from who you're attached to. Hey, I'm Wes, I'm Gene's son. Or, hey, my name is Wes, I work at Coastal, or whatever. And you can actually learn a good bit. This is, so we haven't talked about this at all. Part of the superpower of communication is like having x-ray glasses. When I was a kid, they used to, in the back of like comic books, they had these ads for x-ray glasses that you could see through walls and stuff. And when you learn about communication, it's like putting on x-ray glasses in a conversation. Like within the first 10 seconds or so of meeting somebody, very often I know a few things about them. And when you watch what people disclose about themselves, they're telling you something. They're telling you what they want to disclose, what they want you to know. And this will make them more comfortable with you. It reduces their uncertainty about you. Reciprocity. This one's closely related. So when I walked up to Kyle, I gave him my hand. And what I expected back was his hand. Reciprocity. Some of you do this in your business. Someone walks in the door, you give them an ink pen. And what you're saying is, I'm going to give you something because I'd like something from you. Hey, I'm going to give you an ink pen because I'd like 2 minutes of your time. Or, hey, I've got a bag of swag back there that Robert sent with me to give you guys. This is legit. It's back there. I need to open it. Oh, hey, Ty. Hey, I didn't see Ty McKinney. I didn't see Ty slip in here. He's our graduate student success coordinator. If any of you guys decide to get a master's degree or a PhD at Coastal, Ty's the guy that's going to make sure that you have success and that you get through the system. And Ty, there's a bag of swag back there by Ty. We give out stuff too. Kiss. Like, whoa, hey, that's not. And you know when people don't understand this, because when you say, hey, how are you doing? And they say, how are you doing? And you say, I'm fine. And you say, how are you doing? And it's like, terrible. Man, I've got. And they go in and they actually tell you how they're doing. You're like, wait a minute. I didn't realize we were playing that game. I was telling you, I was doing reciprocity. But it reduces people's uncertainty. They give you what they want back. And so very often, what they're giving you is saying, by giving you something, they're saying, can I please have this from you? It would help me out if I knew your name and where, I would feel better if I knew your name and what you do for a living. So I'm going to walk up and say, hey, I'm Wes. I'm a professor at Coastal. If you don't think this is true, the next time someone does that, don't do it. Introduce yourself to me.
Hey, Joe, I'm Kyle. Nice to meet you.
Hey.
What's up?
And you're like, got nothing.
It's like, what? That's not right. Not a lot of reciprocity. Similarity. People look for similarities, especially at the beginning of an encounter or relationship. At Coastal, what happens is that these students come from Maryland and Jersey and different places, and the first week of classes, their roommate is their best friend. Oh my gosh, you would not believe Becky. She is amazing. We're like best friends. Like, we have so much in common, because they spent that week talking about, you like vanilla? I like vanilla. Ha ha, sisters. You know, like I think, right? And then about week two, when they stop looking for similarities, they're like, hey, why'd you leave your underwear on the floor? Like, what? Or, how come you're not washing the dishes? Or whatever. And what happens is they stop looking for similarities and they start seeing differences. And by week three, they're like, how do I get a different roommate? Like, I thought you and Becky were best friends. Yeah, so did I, but she turns out she's weird. You've had this before too. Yeah, this is first date. Like, she's amazing, he's amazing. And then two or three dates and he's like, uh-huh. He was better when I was drinking. You know, or whatever. Like, we look for similarities. We have a theory about that one too, by the way. We look for similarities. If you will provide them, it will help people. And some of you do this intuitively. You look for commonalities and then you highlight them. Hey, I see that you got a Gamecocks on there. How about that, you know, that quarterback? Or, you know, I'm a big Gamecock fan too, or whatever. We look for these similarities and we underscore them because we know this intuitively. It makes people more comfortable with us. Hey, you got Coastal on your shirt. My nephew went to Coastal. He loved it. And you get into a conversation, and what you underscore are the ways that you're similar, and people are like, oh yeah, I like that guy, or I like her. She's nice. By the way, I'm not recommending that you look like a NASCAR driver, but if you can have things on you or near you or in your office that are opportunities for similarity, you've just increased by a factor of ever how many you have the opportunities for someone to see similarities. Oh my goodness, you like fishing. Disney World, you went to Disney World? If you think about ways you can show similarity with other people or let them find similarities with you, it increased. That's why, so this is one of the misunderstandings. People think social media is for advertising. Social media is for uncertainty reduction. Your business having all sorts of things on their social media site that lets people find similarities, your personal stuff, if you'll allow some of your personal stuff to be on, just create a personal business account where it's separate from your family and friends and stuff, but maybe you have on there the TV shows that you like, or some, you went to the CCMF, or if you'll have some of that kind of content on there, and a few of the, like I teach the students, they should start their freshman year building their social media profile for their job interview. Because those employers, legal or not, they're going to go back and look at the last 3 or 4 years of feeds, and if they see the student standing on a table with two beers in a hand, that's different than they see them going on a study abroad. Or see them, you know, pictures from their internship or other social pictures and stuff, but it allows them to find connections with them, even if they never mention them. Building similarities. Liking. This one is really interesting to me. A researcher at the University of Michigan about 30 years ago now, One summer, he was going to do a research project. He studied persuasion, and he decided, you know what? I'm not doing any more lab experiments. I'm going to go out into the real world, and I'm just going to get a job. And he got a job working as someone who persuades people to make a very, very large purchase from a stranger. Do you know what he did? Exactly. That's exactly right, Stephanie. He sold cars. He got a job for a summer selling cars. Now, he didn't really want to sell cars. What he wanted to do was watch the other salesmen. And he did. And he found that there were two or three that always were at the top of the leaderboard. Every week, they would have more sales than anybody else. So he started watching what was different between the two of them. They had all gone through the same training material. They all had the same, you know, let me talk to my manager. You know, that they all had the same, you know, protocol that they followed, all that kind of stuff. But for some reason, these two or three guys, and people would say things like, I don't know, Kyle's just better at it. I mean, it's just natural for him, or whatever. Some of this intuitively. They like I said about the reciprocity and stuff. But what he discovered that was different about those two, one of the things he discovered, was that there was something wrong with their desk. Anyone ever heard the story about what was wrong with their desk? Everybody, all the salespeople, had been encouraged to put pictures of their family on their desk, family and friends and that sort of stuff, and so everybody did. But these two guys, there was something different. You know what it was? The pictures were turned the wrong way. So when they sat down at their desk, all they saw were the backs of picture frames. They couldn't even see their own family and friends. But you know who could? The customers. So they would sit down and was like, is this your son? My son went on a fishing trip. And what they did was they created an opportunity for liking the moment the person sat down and saw those photos. I have four big photos of my kids in my office. My kids hate it. It's what I asked for my birthday every year is an update of those photos. They don't hate it. They're just like, Dad. I'm like, seriously, this is putting food on your table. like, you got braces because of those photos on the wall. And it's set up where as soon as someone comes in, I can see it. Ty, they're right on my wall, right? As soon as you come in, you see them right there on the right. And then I've got pictures of some other families and friends and some of my mentors and different things around my office and stuff. Now, some of that's for me because I like being surrounded by the photos of the people that I love. But the way that they're arranged is not for me. And there's a lot of other things that you can do. Now, as you know, because you've experienced this, people go overboard with this and try too hard to be liked. This is talking about providing an opportunity for someone who's looking to like you, to make a connection with you, and it dramatically affects your ability to persuade. If you think about who the most persuasive people in your life are, they're probably your family and friends. When you think about politics or buying something or making big decisions in life, those are probably the people you talk to, family and friends. Those are probably the people you like. It's rare, rare for someone to have someone they dislike that they, except for someone who's maybe an authority in something. Last one's easy, and you guys do this too, is shared networks. That's why so many of you have joined clubs, or that's why you're here, right? That's why you're part of the chamber, and to network with other people, because the more shared networks you have, the more people, and the idea is that if you and I share a network, something that I like about me, I now know about you. Oh, you're an Alabama fan too? Roll Tide, I like you. It tells me something, it allows me to take something about me and project that on you. Oh, you like Ed Sheeran too? I like him. This is what happens. This is one of the things that Facebook leveraged when Zuckerberg was first getting started and got some good advice from some people. Allow people to show the networks that they're part of because people will like and go after people that are in shared networks. I like this about me, so now I like it about you, because you're part of it. And I thoroughly have enjoyed hanging out with you guys this time and the last time. And I wish you the best in your uncertainty reduction in the marketplace, and your relationships and your workplace and everything.